Hey everyone, and welcome back to my channel. My name is Josh, and this is your stimulus check update for the next stimulus package for Sunday, October 18th. I hope everyone is off to a good and safe start to their Sunday so far, and that you're all having a wonderful weekend. In this video, I'll be discussing updates in regards to the next relief package and the second stimulus check. I'll also be discussing unemployment, what we can expect over the next few days as far as the relief discussions go, and then I'll be wrapping up this video by answering some of the comments and questions that I received in my previous video. But first, if you wouldn't mind real quickly liking this video, give me a big thumbs up. It really just helps with the YouTube algorithm in terms of pushing this video out to other viewers like you, and hopefully helping other people like you as well. Okay, so with more than 2 million hospitality jobs disappearing over this pandemic, and another 38,000 US hotels possibly being forced to close over the next 6 months, some in the industry are beginning to wonder if things will ever get better. The CEO of Best Western, David Kong, said that if we don't get a vaccine soon and business doesn't return, it's going to get much worse. Kong was one of the many people who met with President Trump at the White House way back in March to discuss federal aid, and he's not the only one expressing deep frustration with the leaders of Congress for failing to reach a bipartisan agreement on another relief package. In fact, with relief negotiations stalled, leading hotel CEOs actually wrote a letter to President Trump pleading for help. They said that his engagement is desperately needed to support struggling businesses, stem the impending wave of foreclosures, and save millions of jobs. The hotel industry isn't the only one hurting. You don't have to look far to see some airlines, restaurants, and cruise lines suffering as well, particularly ones in states that are still shut down. Oh, and you know who else is suffering? American families, and a lot of American families work in these industries, so they do sort of go hand in hand. All in all, it's been a real tough situation for everyone around, and Congress hasn't made it much better by failing to act on the next relief package. In other stimulus-related news, with Treasury Secretary Steven Mnuchin leading a delegation to Israel, Bahrain, and the UAE, we may not hear much negotiations between him and Nancy Pelosi over the next few days. Oh, but of course, not even being in a different country could keep Mnuchin and Pelosi apart, so they'll continue having discussions, with another one scheduled for today, but who really knows what's going to come out of it. Clearly, Mnuchin will have his hands full, and stimulus talks probably won't be at the forefront of his agenda. So, you might say, well, that's fine. President Trump's negotiator is away. Why can't President Trump just step in? Well, he could, but him and the House Speaker haven't even spoken for an entire year now. I'm not sure if the White House has some type of record book for that, but I'm sure it has to be some type of record for the President and House Speaker to not even have one conversation for an entire year. But yeah, if any time was the right time to break the silence, now would be a pretty good time. You know, when millions of American families are suffering and are in desperate need of financial relief. But hey, I guess that's their call. It's probably better they don't talk, since that could possibly push the two sides even further apart, and after all, Mnuchin and Pelosi have clinched several major deals in the past. Of course, at this point, there are still some major roadblocks that the two sides need to get through in order to reach a deal. In Pelosi's recent letter to her colleagues, she cited that these disagreements included, but weren't limited to, funding for state and local government, tax benefits for working families, support for small businesses, and child care funding. Pelosi also cited multiple poison pills, as she called them, which included liability protections for business owners. This, of course, is something that Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell has been a strong advocate for because he believes that businesses would feel much better about opening back up, knowing that they couldn't be sued if someone could prove that they got the virus in their place of business. So it should be really interesting if some type of liability protection for business owners will be able to make it into the deal, as long as Republicans allow something that Nancy Pelosi and other Democrats want, such as more money for state and local governments. On the flip side of things, we also have Mitch McConnell setting up new roadblocks, the overall size of the deal. We have Donald Trump coming out and saying he's prepared to go well beyond the $1.8 trillion mark, and Mitch McConnell says this would be a much larger amount than what he could sell to his members in the Senate. Now, Steven Mnuchin did tell Nancy Pelosi that Trump would weigh in with McConnell if they were to reach an agreement, just to make sure that any agreement could also make it through the Senate as well. Trump, on the other hand, is much more confident than McConnell is that a large stimulus would pass through the Senate. One of President Trump's economic advisors, Larry Kudlow, also spoke in great confidence about Senate Republicans passing any deal. Kudlow said that if Speaker Pelosi wanted a deal, I think we could round up enough Senate Republicans to get a deal. Now, keep in mind here, even if only 15 Republicans in the Senate approved of the deal, you could have 60 votes if all 45 Democrats approved of it. It really wouldn't require many Republicans in the Senate to be in favor of the bill to pass it through. However, at the same time, it's perfectly possible that all Republicans would reject it if it didn't include something they're really in favor of, such as liability protections for business owners. Kudlow went on to say that the important point here is you only have a few weeks until the election, and even if you made a deal, it would be almost impossible to execute. This is also a great point by Kudlow. At this point, we are only 17 days away from Election Day, and if a deal doesn't pass before then, it's possible we could be waiting for a while. Both sides want a deal. Both sides want most of the same things in this deal. At this point, it's all about execution and waiting to see which side will just go ahead and compromise with the other, all so Americans can finally get the relief that they've been waiting for. In the meantime, all we can continue to do is hang in there, stay strong, and hope for the best. In unemployment news, we are still waiting on 5 states to begin paying out the benefits from the Lost Wages Assistance Program. Normally, I would just say there were only 4 states we are still waiting on, but residents in the state of Virginia still haven't received the $300 federal plus up from FEMA. Now, it is my hope that residents in Virginia will begin receiving these payments as early as Monday the 19th. As far as residents in New Jersey go, they should also be receiving their payments all in one lump sum payment beginning this week as well. Residents in Nevada are expected to begin receiving their payments on October 21st, and Wisconsin residents are expected to receive their payments around October 31st. Unfortunately, we still haven't received any expected payment dates for the Lost Wage Assistance Program for the residents of Alaska, but we can only hope that it won't be too much longer before they begin receiving their payments. Also, since most states have already completely depleted their funds from FEMA, we now have to wait until Congress can finally get their act together and pass another relief package in order to extend these benefits on a longer-term, more stable basis. Okay, so at this point in time, I'm going to move right along to answering some of the comments and questions that I received in my previous video. And if you do have any other comments or questions for me, please feel free to leave them in the comment section below. I do try to answer as many of the comments and questions as I possibly can, but for those comments and questions I'm not able to respond to, I do try to pick some of the more popular ones to answer in the next video and video forum. Okay, so without further ado, let me go ahead and jump into the first comment of today's video, which is from Shauna. Shauna says, "Will people that owe past due child support receive a stimulus check this time?" Thank you so much for your question, Shauna, and at this point, that's still relatively unknown. In the recent plans by Democrats, they make it so those with past due child support won't have their stimulus payments garnished. However, in recent plans by Republicans, they make it so those with past due child support would end up having their stimulus payments garnished. In the end, it's my best guess that those with past due child support will end up having their payments garnished just because they were in the CARES Act and that was a bipartisan bill. With that said, I will definitely keep you updated if anything does happen to change. Okay, moving right along to the next question of today's video, which is from Nicole. Nicole says, "Do non-filers have to file again for the second stimulus?" All right, thank you so much for your question, Nicole, and non-filers should not need to file again if another stimulus check does pass. Since the IRS should already have all of your information from using the non-filers tool in the first round, there really shouldn't be a need for everyone to fill it out again. With that said, I will definitely make sure to keep you updated if anything does happen to change there as well. All right, moving along to the next question of today's video, which is from Anita. Anita says, "Is Nancy agreeable to $400 per week enhanced unemployment, or is she still at $600 per week?" Thank you for your question, Anita. And at the moment, Pelosi is still stuck at her $600 per week unemployment figure. Now, other Democrats, such as House Majority Leader Steny Hoyer, have said the weekly unemployment figure is negotiable. However, it's still unknown whether or not Pelosi will ever end up compromising on that figure. Let's hope that as time moves along, pressure from other moderate Democrats makes Pelosi more willing to compromise. Okay, moving right along to the last question of today's video, which is from Chuan. Chuan says, "Hi Josh, I receive SSI and SSDI. My first check was deposited on my Direct Express card. Is it going to happen again, or do I have to file?" Thank you for your question, and since you received your first payment on your Direct Express card, you should also be receiving the second payment that way as well. You shouldn't have to do anything to receive your payment, as it will be sent that way automatically. However, if you do wish to change the method in which you'll receive your next payment, You can always update your preferred payment method through the payment portal on the IRS website. Otherwise, as I just mentioned, no action will be required on your part, and you'll receive the payment on your Direct Express card. Alright, so on that note, I'm going to go ahead and wrap up this video. If you did enjoy the content in this video, and you'd like to see more videos like it, please consider subscribing to my YouTube channel. It is completely free to do so, and it's a great support to me. Also, if you'd like to receive 2 free stocks from Webull, with both stocks valued all the way up to $1,600, please feel free to claim those 2 free stocks by clicking the link in the description box below. And until next time, I'll see you guys, and I hope you have a great day today.